All of you would have heard about erector spinae plane block. Some would have given it, some would have seen somebody else giving it, at least you would have read about it. But after this tutorial, I want to make sure that all of you should be able to give it. Erectospinae plane block, it was introduced back in 2016. It was introduced by Ferrero et al. He used it for the management of chronic neuropathic pain in patients who had rib metastasis. But afterwards, it started being used for acute pain, chronic pain. There is a multitude of situations where you can use erectospinae plane block. It is an interfacial plane block, that is, you are injecting the drug in a facial plane rather than concentrating on a nerve plexus or a particular nerve. Being an erectospinae muscle, a paraspinal muscle, this block is otherwise called as paraspinal facial plane block. We will be discussing the block in detail in regard to the anatomy, the technique of injection, the mechanism of action of the drug, and if you know about the anatomy, technique and mechanism, obviously you will be able to understand the indications, contraindications, and in addition, I'll be giving you a few tips so that you can make the maximum out of the block. If you see the anatomy of erectospinae plane block, it is basically the erectospinae muscle. As I said, it's a paraspinal muscle. It is a deep muscle of the back which is seen just superficial to your vertebra. It extends from your nuchal fascia, that is in the neck level, to the level of pelvis and sacrum. And from medial to lateral, it has got three parts. That is, you have the spinalis part, you have the longissimus part, and you have the iliocostalis part. Three parts. And each part has got subparts. This is not much relevant for us. So what you should know about is, it is seen just superficial to the vertebra. Just superficial to the erectospinae muscle, you have the rhomb. Body is minor and major, which is seen in the upper thoracic level, and in the lower thoracic and the lumbar level you have a latissimus dorsi. So rhomboid is minor, major, and the latissimus dorsi forms the superficial to the erectospinae muscle. Further superficial to the rhomboid is minor, major, and latissimus dorsi, you have your trapezius. So what is the importance of knowing about these muscles? There are two things. First is that it will help you to understand the ultrasound anatomy. Second is that where you will be injecting your local anesthetic. Local anesthetic can be injected in two places. So it can be injected either between the transverse process and the erectospinae muscle, or between the erectospinae muscle and the rhomboides major, minor, or latissimus dorsi. So what difference does it make with these type of injection? That will come to know when you are seeing the associated neuroanatomy. So if you see the relevant neuroanatomy, the only thing what you should know is that how the spinal nerve emerge out of the spinal cord. So basically it forms the spinal root and comes out of the intervertebral foramen, and afterwards it is seen anterior to the transverse process. Here is where your local anesthetic is going to interact with the nerves when you are giving a local anesthetic in erectospinae plane. So after the nerve emerges out, it can divide into dorsal rami and a ventral rami. The dorsal rami is the one which comes posteriorly and supply the skin and muscle of the back. The ventral rami will continue anteriorly and laterally and supply the anterior and lateral part of chest and abdomen. So when you are giving injection in between the erectospinae and the rhomboides minor, major, or latissimus dorsi, the dorsal rami can be easily blocked. But the ventral rami, whether it will be blocked, it is not sure. But if you inject in between the transverse process and erectospinae muscle, it is sure that it will block the ventral rami as well as dorsal rami. So deeper injection, that is between the transverse process and erectospinae, is the one which is found to be more useful. You inject in between the transverse process or erectospinae, or you inject more superficially, it is acting at the level of nerve root, ventral rami, dorsal rami. How they came up to this conclusion? This is based on contrast or dye studies and MRI studies. In few studies, it is found that drug crosses into the epidural space, and in few studies, it is found that drug crosses into the paravertebral space. So the exact mechanism of action is still not understood. Only thing you should know is that if you give average volume of drug at this level, it can spread up to 4 to 5 spinal levels up and 4 to 5 spinal levels down. So when you select the site of injection of erectospinae plane block, you should know the area of coverage which you need. The midpoint of that should be the area of injection of your local anesthetic. So the main thing which you should notice in erectospinae plane block is that when you inject on one side, it will block the segment of spinal nerves on that side. Now we will see the technique of injection of local anesthetic. We are discussing about ultrasound guided technique. There is a blind landmark based technique also which has been mentioned. In ultrasound guided technique, the main thing is the probe size. The probe which we normally use is a curvilinear low frequency probe, especially because you want to see the deeper structures. But when you are seeing in mid thoracic region or upper thoracic region where structures are more superficial, a linear high frequency probe can be used instead. It can be done in sitting position, it can be done in lateral position, or even in prone position. So the first step in doing the technique is identifying modifying the level. As I said earlier, when you give the block, it can spread almost 4 to 5 dermatomes up and down if you give a standard volume. The level can be decided either by through anatomical landmarks, which we classically use for epidural or spinal technique, or it can be done using ultrasound guided spine scanning. Ultrasound guided spine scanning is a big another entity. I'll be taking another video on that. So once you found out the exact level of the block where you want to give, then you have different ways in which you can give the block. If you see the approaches for erector spinal plane block, we have 4 approaches. These are the ultrasound guided approaches. We have the classic approach, Tulgar approach, we have the Aksu approach, and we have the Rack approach. In addition to this, we have a blind technique which I've said earlier. We'll be discussing in a bit about that also. Coming to the classic approach for erector spinal plane block, it all starts with identifying the midline scan. So midline sagittal scan is performed at the level of your spinous processes, and from here you come laterally and scan in the parasagittal plane. So when you come laterally from the spinous process in the parasagittal plane, what you'll be seeing first is your lamina. It is a discontinuous structure, so it will have a slope followed by a gap, again slope followed by a gap. This is classically called as your horse head sign. When you come further laterally in the parasagittal plane with scanning, you will be seeing the articular process, which is the continuous line with hump like appearance. This is called as sawtooth pattern, or otherwise called as camel hump sign. From here we have to come further laterally to reach our transverse process, which you will be seeing as our trident sign. So trident sign, along with the overlying muscle, that is the trapezius superficially, in between you will have the rhomboides minor, major, or latissimus dorsi, and further deep you will be having your erector spinae muscle. Along with the trident sign is a place you will be giving your classic erector spinae plane block. In classic erector spinae plane block, as I said earlier, you have a deep injection technique or a superficial injection technique. Deep injection technique, you will be injecting between the transverse process and the erector spinae muscle. Superficial injection technique, you will be injecting between the erector spinae and the other superficial muscle. In the parasagittal scan for erector spinae plane block, especially in thoracic level, when you reach laterally, there could be a confusion with identification of transverse process and rib. Transverse process, as you can see in the image, it will be more superficial and it will be more square shaped. And when you come to the rib, it will be more deep compared to the transverse process and it will be more round in shape. And there will be an intervening pleura at this level. Coming to the scanning for the rack approach. In the rack approach, what you will be seeing is that instead of doing a classical sagittal or parasagittal scan, we will be going ahead with a transverse scan as shown in the image. What is the advantage of doing rack approach? Rack approach, you are having a transverse scan. The main problem they have felt with the parasagittal scan is that if you are injecting the drug into the erector spinae muscle, visually it will be seen as separation of the facial plane between the transverse process and erector spinae muscle. This problem is avoided in transverse approach, where if you inject into the erector spinae muscle, it can be seen as a circular collection rather than lamination or facial separation. That is the advantage of rack approach. It is called as a rack approach because we can see the muscles and the transverse process arranged in a rack-like manner. Another extra advantage if you see with the rack approach is that here we can clearly identify between the transverse process and rib. As I said, you can see the transverse process, which is seen superficially, and the rib will be seen as a deeper structure. This identification is easy with the rack approach when compared to the classic parasagittal technique. Tulgar approach for erector spinae plane block, it is used for lumbar level. This approach for lumbar erector spinae plane block, it can be considered as a modification of our lumbar plexus block. Here we'll be injecting the local anesthetic both anterior to the transverse process as well as the posterior to the transverse process. Posterior to transverse process is the area where we commonly inject for erector spinae plane block. Only thing here is that we will be injecting an additional injection anterior to the transverse process. So here the muscle which we come across is our psoas major muscle. Within the substance of psoas major muscle is where we have our lumbar plexus. If we inject anterior to the transverse process, that is between the transverse process and psoas major muscle, you can get approach to the lumbar plexus more easily. And this is an alternate way of blocking the lumbar plexus through the erector spinae approach. Lumbar erector spinae plane block via the Tulgar approach, it can be done in two ways. Like we do in QL block, we can have a transverse scan at the flank and you can see the classic shamrock sign and you can inject the drug as is shown in the figure. Or else we can have a classic parasagittal scan, how we do in the case of classic approach, and you can inject the drug here as well. In the shamrock technique for injection for Tulgar approach, it is clearly understood that where we'll be injecting, you inject just posterior to the transverse process as well as just anterior to the transverse process. In the parasagittal technique for erector spinae plane block, we'll be injecting, one is at the classic side, that is between the transverse process and the erector spinae muscle, and you get a typical spread.
spread.
Second site of injection is just posterior to that is between the transverse fossa and the psoas major muscle. So if you inject here, it is found that you can block the lumbar plexus component. So when it was first described, the Tulgar approach, it was used for analgesic purpose. It was not used as a sole anesthetic technique. So we have to see the future advancements which can happen in this field. In Tulgar approach, it is said that we have to inject almost 20 ml of the local anesthetic anterior to the transverse process and another 20 ml of the local anesthetic posterior to the transverse process to get the desired clinical effect. If you see the axial approach for erectus minor plane block, the site of injection of the local anesthetic is same as that of the classic approach, only that we are seeing the structures through a different view. Here we are seeing through a transverse scan that is at the level of your flank and it is called as your shamrock sign. So this is the difference in the technique with the axial approach. Rest, the site of injection of the local anesthetic and the amount of the local anesthetic given is same. In the blind technique or the landmark technique for erectus minor plane block, we follow the landmarks. That is, after once you have identified the level at which you want to give the block, you identify the midline. From midline, you take 3 cm lateral and from there you inject the needle perpendicular to the skin, cross the superficial muscles to reach the transverse process. Classically, at the thoracic level, you will reach the transverse process at around 2 to 4 cm depth. Once you get the resistance of the transverse process, you aspirate and you inject the local anesthetic. That is the blind technique for erectus minor plane block. You can use a continuous technique with blind technique as well. In ultrasound guided, we have an option for single technique or a continuous catheter technique. The length of the needle which is used for single technique for erectus minor plane block in any of the approaches depending upon the depth at which the transverse process is reached. Classically, you can use either 5 cm, 8 cm or 10 cm needle. A 22 gauge or 23 gauge needle will be enough. Needle can be inserted in plane or out of plane. In plane, either cranial to caudal or caudal to cranial direction can be used. In rack approach, we can use medial to lateral direction or lateral to medial direction. Drugs are used at the concentration of bupivacaine 0.25%, ropivacaine 0.375% and levobupivacaine also 0.25%. The amount of local anesthetic needed for the spread is said to be around 10 to 20 ml. For pediatric age, 0.5 ml per kg is the dose which we give for one side. When you are going ahead with a continuous catheter technique, you will be using an 18 gauge 2A needle or even a 16 gauge 2A needle can be used and the associated catheter can be used. Once you've got the plane in which you have to inject the local anesthetic, first you initially expand the space by injecting almost 3 to 5 ml of local anesthetic or normal saline. Once you have expanded the space, you proceed with catheter insertion and you insert the catheter almost 5 cm into the space. Then you inject rest of the local anesthetic through the catheter. Afterwards, the catheter can be taken out through tunneling technique. In catheter technique or in continuous technique, normally we give around 0.125% of bupivacaine can be given or even 0.2% of ropivacaine can be given at a rate of 5 ml per hour. Along with that, patient controlled boluses of around 8 ml or 6 ml can be given at a low cut interval of 60 minutes. Additives can be used when you are giving erectus minor plane block. Dexamethasone or any other additive can be used. Classically, you get a duration of around 8 to 12 hours when you are giving erectus minor plane block. And it has been found out that adding additives, it can reduce the opioid consumption for up to 24 hours. Coming to the indications for erectus minor plane block, if you have understood the mechanism of action, obviously you will be able to get out the indication for erectus minor plane block. If you see the erectus minor plane block given at the cervical level, it can be used for analgesia for your shoulder procedure. If you give the erectus minor plane block at the upper thoracic level, it can be used for upper thoracic breast surgeries. And if you give at the lower thoracic or the lumbar level, you will be able to get the analgesia for the abdominal procedures. And if you give at the lumbar level, you will be able to get the analgesia for the lower limb procedure. So this is as simple as that. As described by the author, initially it was used for the management of rib metastasis pain management, that is for the chronic pain. Nowadays, they are giving erectus minor plane block at the thoracic level with the local anesthetic along with a steroid like triamcinolone. They were able to get the analgesic effect up to 4 months. So if you see the most common scenarios where erectus minor plane block is used, it is used for first breast surgery, second for rib fracture pain management, third it is used for lumbar or thoracic or any spine surgeries, fourth is that it is used for management of lower limb analgesia. Coming to the contraindications of erectus minor plane block, we have only two absolute contraindications. One is patient refusal, second is infection at the paraspinal site where you are going to inject the local anesthetic. Coming to the anticoagulation and erectus minor plane block, the 2018 ASRA guideline, there has been no specific mention about anticoagulants and deeper plane blocks like erectus minor plane block. But in the Astra site, as an explanation for erectospinae plain block, they have mentioned that anticoagulation is not a specific contraindication for erectospinae plain block. You have to assess patient risk versus benefit analysis, and accordingly you have to take for each patient. If you see the complications for erectospinae plain block, as you know that there are no major structures related to erectospinae plain block. Common complications which are seen with erectospinae plain block are infection at the site of injection, local anesthesia, toxicity or allergy. You can have a failed block, and very rarely it has been reported to cause pneumothorax because of the associated pleura if you are giving it in a wrong site. That is, if you fail to identify between the transverse process and the rib. Few other complications which are very rarely reported are motor blockade and priapism. And another specific which you should be careful about Tulgar approach is that if you are giving the anterior injection, that is between the transverse process and the psoas major muscle, the abdominal branches of the lumbar arteries cross through the psoas major muscle, so there could be a possibility of intravascular injection, or you can have a hematoma or bleeding there. Coming to the advantages of giving a erectospinal plain block, first is that it is easy to perform, second is that it can be performed with minimal or no sedation for the patient, third is that there is no major structures in the immediate vicinity, so that you have less complications associated with erectospinal plain block. Fourth is that if you give for thoracic procedures and all, it is found out to have patient having improved respiratory effort, early weaning from mechanical ventilation, and you have shorter hospital stay. And in most cases where you give epidural or paravertebral block, the complication associated with them can be reduced. For epidural, if you give, you have risk of hypotension, which is not there with erectospinal plain block. For paravertebral, you have risk of pleural puncture and you have risk of bleeding, so that is also avoided. If you are giving for intercostal plain block, you have risk of pneumothorax or pleural puncture, that is also avoided. So complications are less because there are not much important structures in the immediate vicinity. Hope all of you would have understood how to give erectospinal plain block, how it acts, where all you can give it. So until we see next time, thank you.